No, no, I'm okay.
Okay, so, once again, my name's Nick Zito. My current capacity, I'm the Business Services Director of Choose DuPage. So my day job, or my real job, is I'm employed by DuPage County. I do business development for all 39 cities here in DuPage County. And as a capacity of that, I run Rev3 Innovation Center. So I'm going to talk a lot about Rev3 later, but that's our business incubator and co-working space here in Naperville. So by the title of the talk, Me LLC, that's actually going to be the name of my upcoming podcast. Me LLC in reality means, you know, in this day and age, in technology and mobile workforce, people can work from anywhere. You can have a laptop, a phone, an iPad, and you can start your company from anywhere. If any of you guys have read the 4-Hour Workweek, it's kind of that mindset. So point being, you know, like you and your company, I'll ask you guys later, but I'm sure you guys wear multiple hats. You're the sales officer, you're the website, you're the marketing, you're the Twitter, you're the Facebook, you're the paid placement. So all of those different mediums, that's all coming under one roof, and people are having to take more responsibility. The second part of the title, how to become a CEO, Chief Entrepreneur Officer, that is my current title. It's on my business card. And again, the idea is, in this day and age, it's easy to start a company. You don't have to invest too much. So again, let's talk a little bit about the outline of what I'm going to be talking about. On the left is an excerpt from my website. I wrote a blog on public speaking. Again, it's not that long ago that I was in college and I hated listening to boring lectures. So again, I want to try to keep this interactive. Please jump in with questions. So I want to try to tangibly outline what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to try to not talk at you. Again, I want to make this a discussion. I want to hear about what you guys are working on as well. Make it personal, care about the topic. If you can't already, this is something I'm really passionate about. I love the intersection of entrepreneurship and public policy. I'll tell you a little bit about more about my background in a bit. So who the heck am I and why am I here? I outlined some of my background before my current capacity. Again, when I was in high school, I went to St. Francis in Wheaton. I really didn't have any business experience, so a lot of what I talk about to, you know, high school and college students, recent graduates, is kind of self-awareness of learning really what you want to do. I think it's really important to, number one, be self-aware enough about what you guys like and what you guys dislike, even in your current companies. So again, on the left, most of my experience in high school and college, I had the life plan I was going to be a lawyer. I took my LSAT. I was an undergrad at University of Illinois, graduated in 2012, took my LSAT as a junior, thought I was going to apply to law school and go right through and be a corporate lawyer. Long story short, I'm happy that I did not do that, for anyone thinking about that. So again, you can't be afraid to change. I've changed my course multiple times, and again, I combined aspects all along the way of what I actually wanted to get into at the end. So again, under the college, you see about the law school. I was involved in clubs. I was on the executive board of Big Brothers Big Sisters mentorship program. I started my first two companies, which I'll talk about in the next slide, as an undergrad. After I graduated, I moved to Washington, D.C. I did a congressional term out there during the 2012 election. So again, most of my experience is government admin. So I studied jobs tax credits. I worked on a couple campaigns in the areas of economics and finance, trying to figure out for better, or most of the times worse, how government affects small business. So this slide's just quick, again, who am I about? Two of my first companies. On the left, you can tell by the name. My idea was to take a funny, interesting branded name, obviously Protein for the guys in the room. I did some research on that name. I actually own the trademark for that name. So again, I was a 20-year-old college kid, all the time in the world, no money. I thought for an kind of active lifestyle on a college campus, you know, kids are going from the bar to the library to class to their job to wherever it may be. I wanted to kind of attack that market style and lifestyle. So again, on the left, you know, when I'm talking about all this business now, when I lecture to students in different groups, I had none of this experience. I had to learn all of this myself. So you can see, I did the legal back work. I heard Tom talking to someone about the Secretary of State and incorporation when I walked in. I had no clue how to do any of that. And you know, since I've filed patents, trademarks, LLCs, and had to do it all by myself. So a lot of what I talk about too is, you know, you have to throw yourself, you know, so to speak, into the fire, and that's the best way to learn. Legal incorporation, distribution, in-store and e-commerce. I think again, one of the biggest things too happening in this day and age is all the different types of digital media, which I'll talk about in another slide. So with this company, I knew that the asset didn't lie in the actual consumable. So our products was four different flavors of actual whey protein bars. I knew that was a brutal market. I knew how I could get ahead was kind of leveraging some of the technologies available at the time and kind of leveraging against those. So what I ended up doing Again, if anyone follows any fitness personalities or kind of lifestyle vlogs on YouTube, I really attacked that influencer-based market. I would do product placement in some YouTube videos that got 400,000 to 600,000 views. Long story short, I'd wake up and check my phone and I would get orders from France, Germany, Australia, Switzerland, Sweden, whatever it may be, just by targeting people who already had big followings, doing commission splits, doing revenue splits with them, and then broadening out from there. Intern networks. One of the best things that I did is I established a college intern network of about 7 interns at about 6 different Big Ten college campuses. So again, being able to incentivize and build teams, I think teamwork and bringing together different skill sets is really a big idea. Social media, I'm going to talk a lot more about that in a bit. 46 states and 13 countries. So that's the totals just from me plus 2 partners, what we shipped orders to from our e-commerce store. So again, to put it in context, I was 20 to 22 years old at the time, knew nothing about anything, and just through a little research and again, throwing myself into this and handling all these different tasks, I experienced a little bit of success, and more importantly than that, it was fun, and now I can go back and leverage that experience and talk about moving past that, what I did wrong, what I did good, and improving upon that. On the right, the Purple Crown is one of my newer companies, popular mention. So the idea behind this, again, is completely influencer-based marketing. So how many of you guys either use or know what the app Vine is? Mm-hmm. With a little green logo? Okay, cool.
I know what it is, but I don't use it.
Okay, so the real quick answer is it's owned by Twitter. It's a 6-second repeating video app that categorizes how much loops or eyeballs are essentially watching each video. Mm-hmm. So I wish I could pull one up, but point being, after Twitter owned it, I kind of followed it for a while, and I'll probably ask you guys the same thing. You would see people jump out, build huge followings on it, but it was silly. It was silly humor, it was stupid 6-second videos, comedy sketches, things like that. I kind of took a look at it right when it came out and followed it and used it. I didn't really create my own content, but I was following some of the popular people. I figured out really quick there's going to be a huge business opportunity here. Lo and behold, fast forward, about 1.5 to 2 years, that's how new it is. Today, the highest paid actor in the world is Robert Downey Jr. He makes about $200 million every 3 Iron Man or Avengers movies that he does. On a per second basis, social media stars and Vine stars in particular make way more money than him. They could post a 6-second video, maybe take like an hour editing it. And again, this is a 6-second video on Vine. They make $30,000 to $60,000 per sponsored post. Oh. So again, on Vine, there was a clear distinction. Again, this is just a social media. It starts out as fun, as friends commenting to each other. And then you could tell really quick, one day when it turned into, hi, my name is Nick, and buy this marker, and there's a link to my marker in the bottom of my Vine profile, that would drive traffic to other websites, that would create sales. That would create commission contracts between these social media celebrities. So again, I lectured to about 600 high school students 2 weeks ago, and this is the demographic. I mean, you see, I walked in with 2 phones, I have an Apple Watch, I have an iPad, I have a computer. All of you guys have the same point being, everyone is constantly connected. So we have to try to leverage these things and take them for face value, meaning they're fun, they're good ways to keep in contact with people, but you guys building your business and anyone else with an idea, think about how to leverage some of these things down the line. So my idea with Popular Mentions is, again, taking that mindset of kind of making a peer connection from social media celebrity or brand influencer to an individual. So again, I can pay these social media celebrities to either place my company or to give my personal page a shout out. Again, people are tracking these metrics on their followers and favorites, and this is a good way to get ahead and, again, incentivize the social media celebrities, because then they're not wasting their effort. Okay, so through these, I want to talk really quick, kind of the meat of the presentation. Again, when I talk to this demographic, kind of my top 5 tips for business students and more specifically business leadership. The disclaimer on this is all my opinion and what I've learned along the way. So I talked in the beginning, I think it's extremely important, that's why this is number 1. You have to find out what you like, and you have to also find out, equally important, what you dislike. And in parentheses it says try, because the only way that's possible is to try. Again, putting myself on the spot and using myself as an example, I've tried multiple things, and I think it's super important to kind of take different jobs, different internships, start a couple ideas. I have an idea notebook that at any one time, I think right now if I checked it, there's about my next 25 business ideas and business, either business ideas or products or services, whatever I want to launch. So again, when I talk about being self-aware, I think you have to know, you know, what you as yourself are capable of. And also I'll talk a lot about networking so you can surround yourselves with some of these skills that you're not proficient in. You don't want to regret, again, when I'm talking to this age group, I don't want to sound like the token old guy in the room, but again, being a couple years out of college, I have so many friends who, you know, wake up and they tell me that, you know, they've been in their job for 2 or 3 years now and they absolutely hate it. And trust me, there is no worse feeling in the entire world than hating what you have to do every day. So again, that's why, you know, before you guys are done, or if you're working at the same time as you're putting yourself through school, constantly be trying things. So by the time you're done, or if you transfer out or whatever it may be, you have something good lined up, or at least know the industry that you want to jump into. Again, the bullets on the bottom. The last one's important too. Teach yourself. Again, like I said, in this day and age, there's no excuse to not know how to do something when you can literally type in YouTube how to file a LLC with Illinois, how to pay sales tax, and this is all things that I did not know how to do until I found out the hard way or had to teach myself. Two, you have to start. Again, I talk about, you know, my ideas notebook with 25 things in it. The biggest thing that I do when I talk to groups like this or entrepreneurs now in my day job, you know, they're talking about, oh, I'm scared of failing, or I'm scared of this, or I don't know how to get my clothing line out there, or I'm not a tech guy. How do I program an app for the Apple Watch or Android Wear? You have to start. And again, you know, we could talk about things all day long, but you're not going to learn anything, you know, whether you start. Now, again, that's not ensuring success, but the only way to know is if you do start. Don't glorify failure, but fail fast, the lean model. Does anyone know what the lean model canvas is, or do you guys use that at all, lean model business canvas? If you don't, you should check it out. I myself will never in my life write another business plan. You should really, really look this up as a way to test your ideas. The word lean literally means you don't need that much to start, and it's the pivot method. I start an idea, again, I'll try to speak as tangibly as possible. When I started my fitness nutrition company, the first thing that I started didn't really work. I only spent about a month on it, so I was able to pivot really quick and try something else. Mm-hmm. So the whole idea is, I'll show a slide with it later. You can see all your 9 key business areas on one slide. You can easily change them as you go along. So instead of wasting time and a 60-page business plan, which is still needed in some settings, so I can't completely dismiss it, you can use a lean model canvas and quickly test ideas. In my current capacity with the DuPage County now, we've probably tested over 25 different business models in the span of about 12 months. Some failed, some took off, some are still going. Point being, it's a good way to start. Costs of starting are low or non-existent. Again, I'm speaking as tangibly as possible. In my 2 companies, I think the most that I literally expensed to start one was maybe $700 on the first one, just because I had to buy a plane ticket to go to a trade show. So point being, again, anyone with an idea in here, or if you're thinking about something, you can buy a domain name, you can buy an email address, and a couple other things for maybe $35 a month and test an idea. So again, it might cost you a couple $100 in 3 months of your time, and if it fails, it fails, but if you have something, you could keep it going. So I'm a really big advocate of testing multiple ideas under the mindset that, you know, 80 to 90% probably will fail, but the ones that pay off are going to be worth it. Again, sweat equity. You don't have to pay people right off the bat. You can either get partners or find out yourself. The quote on the bottom is from one of my favorite business personalities who I saw speak in Chicago a couple weeks ago, Mark Cuban. He talks about his story. He went to Indiana University. He started a bar that got closed down. After Indiana, he was a banker, still didn't know what he wanted to do. Went to Dallas, started a computer company, made his first $1 million, and then he later sold broadcast.com to Yahoo, which made him his $1 billion. Point being, he talks about, no one remembers those stories about what he didn't get right or what he failed on. You're only gonna be remembered as, oh, you're the girl who did that, or you're the guy who did this company. So again, it's just a mindset of, you have to try these ideas because they'll be worth it. 3, seek mentorship. Sometimes a controversial topic, again, still speaking about Mark Cuban, when I saw him speak, he said that he's against mentors, for the reason being how I kind of opened. He thinks you need to be able to do everything yourself, and that's the best way to learn. I think I'm somewhere more in the middle. I don't really have any formal mentors, but I do have a couple people in different areas that I kind of tap for advice. Again, I'm going to talk about networking and how to surround yourselves with positive role models and positive people. I love that first bullet point. You're the average of the five people you hang with. Again, surround yourself with success. Through what I do, I've formed a great personal network now. Whenever I need a technology person or an iOS developer or an Android or a manufacturer, whatever it may be, I can easily go and tap someone on the shoulder and say, you know, I met you at so-and-so event, or I helped you with this, you know, can I kind of lean on you for advice? Offer an internship. Don't just take, offer advice and help too. So how to get mentors? Again, there's no excuse in this day and age. I'll use myself as an example. Solely through Twitter, I've connected with two people in DuPage County within a couple cities who have sold billion-dollar companies. I blindly reached out to them, and I invited them out to lunch and got some advice from them. Again, recognize these type of social medias as, you know, what the older demographic would call fun and time-wasting and stupid, but utilize those. Again, putting myself on the spot, probably up until a year ago, I used Twitter solely, you know, to mess around my friends. I would favorite things. I would make stupid videos, tag my friends in them. And then again, there was kind of that turning point where I realized I have a direct pipeline to reach out to anyone in the world that I want to. Now, again, just because I tweet Mark Cuban or tweet someone like that doesn't mean they're going to respond. But if I send out 10, maybe I get one or two responses. So that's another tangible method that I've used. Keep in contact, again, when you're forming these business relationships, like these people that I referenced. I see Tom nodding. You can't just reach out to someone and say, hey, give me $100,000 or give me this or give me that, and then never talk to them again. It's a relationship like anything else. You have to keep it up, foster it, and you know, don't just be a taker. You have to give advice. Another practical, tangible idea is reach out to someone. Make a list of 10 people in 10 industries or 5 industries that you really like and value, and give them advice, or make a list of top 5 ideas for an industry that they're in. That's something I've used a couple times. So I would write a blog post and send it to someone saying, hey, I saw you were writing about effective communication in the workplace. Here's what I've seen have worked, or I really liked your point on X, Y, or Z. So again, show interest. It's like any other relationship in life. Take multiple qualities from different mentors. Again, you don't just have to have one mentor who is your business mentor or something like that. Have, you know, if you're not a tech person, but you want to be in that sphere, talk to someone who's maybe raised some angel investment money, who's in the VC world, who has sold a company, who is in kind of that programming landscape. Take multiple qualities from multiple people. Network. You'll see in a later slide why I'm such a big fan about this. Again, you can see my second slide going back to the Twitter. Utilize all of these things. Again, I've formed so much connections like this. You can see in parentheses, Marcus Lemonis, he's the host of CNBC's The Profit Show. I've connected with him. I saw him speak in Chicago. I wrote a blog about him. I sent it to him. We were commenting back and forth, and then other people were jumping into the conversation. So again, make friends, learn, and improve. Number one, it's fun to have a good network. So again, you can build thought leadership or build credibility as that guy or girl who's, you know, always making connections. If you know two people who should be connected, you could obviously tell why social media is the first bullet. Meetups. Tom knows he's came to a few of our events. I use meetup.com. I built our membership from 0 members to 407 members. Solely by putting in the interests that I want to foster, and then it automatically shoots out invites and then invites people to events. I would recommend everyone make a profile on there. It's free if you're just making a profile. If you're making a group, you have to pay. Mm-hmm. And I'll say at the end, you guys are all invited to join my networking events as well. So again, put yourself out there through Meetup. Again, what's the company you're working on, or what's your idea?
Divine Designs.
Okay, and you were apparel and clothing?
Me and clothing, yeah.
Cool. So again, you could form profiles. You can go to, you know, textile manufacturing or how to get retail distribution or short shelf space, how to, you know, sell your products digitally via e-commerce. I had some apparel too, and it's a really hard business, but when you can go direct to the point of consumer, you can make some pretty big margins. Roundtables, so again, speaking as tangibly as possible, something else I've done, I literally have made a list of my top 5 people either that I want to meet or that I have met, and I keep them all in contact. So I host a, you know, simple monthly lunch or monthly breakfast, no agenda, just keeping these networks alive. That's how I've got a lot of my referrals. And so I've been able to kick a lot of referrals out as well. Again, offer value. It's not just a one-sided thing. Focus on your strengths. Another really, really big point of mine, do one thing really well. So kind of throughout my opening, again, I talk a lot about building this credibility. So again, I'll use myself as an example. I feel like I do 8 to 9 things pretty well, just because, again, I threw myself into it and I was forced to learn. I feel like I do 1 to 3 things very well. And again, I'm building thought leadership and credibility in that arena. So I think it's good to be broad-based. And again, like I talked about in the beginning, I was the sales guy. I was the legal guy. I worked with the lawyers to get the patents and the trademarks. I was also the one, I'm not a tech guy, but I had to help build our website. I had to help do our e-commerce overlay. So am I great at those things? No, but at least I have a standing understanding and knowledge base on them. But again, putting that aside, really focus on those 1 to 2 things that you know you're great at. Again, tangible advice. Ask a teacher, ask a friend, maybe not your parents because they might not be honest. Ask a friend or someone you respect to literally list your top 3 and your maybe worst 3 or kind of less strong characteristics. Look at the list, compare it, and again, maybe you like sales, but you're really not comfortable talking to people or pressuring people. Maybe people are giving you feedback saying, hey, you know, you're a really good listener. Maybe you should look at HR or communications or something like that. So again, be as tangible as possible. Find it out. Work your strengths, hire your weakness. Again, that's one of my favorite business quotes. I will call myself out. I'm a great long-term thinker and strategic long-term goal-oriented thinker. I suck at day-to-day details. Mm-hmm. So what did I do? I hired someone who could act as assistant and act as a day-to-day operations manager. And again, I asked for that feedback and people told me, and I was self-aware enough to realize it. Find co-founders. Again, I host events, and there's events all over the place called co-founders. They're kind of speed dating or speed networking for co-founders. Again, if anyone's looking to launch an app or some type of tech product and you're not a tech person, go to one of these, start building some relationships. You'll meet, you know, plenty of iPhone, Apple, Android, whatever it may be, developers. And thought leadership, again, curious to see, does anyone in the room, are you focused on trying to build any type of personal brand outside of social media? Meaning, does anyone have a domain website with your name, or are you putting out writing?
Martin, don't you have something?
Well, I just bought a domain.
Cool.
And now I'm just in the process of building a website myself.
Cool, good for you. What are you using, WordPress?
Well, for now, WordPress, because it's really quick. Yeah. I can do it for a couple of hours, but in the future, I'm just gonna write it in HTML myself.
Cool, awesome. But back to my point, you started. So again, and this is something I'm actually upset that I didn't do earlier. I didn't do this till I was out of college and started working. I had, you saw in the beginning, I'll play it at the end. I have my domain. I'm starting to put out content there. Again, when I'm speaking to different groups or on my business card, I'm starting to put it. And then again, you're building credibility. So if people think about, you know, oh, I want to find that HTML guy, or I want to find the guy who is doing the apparel, they'll associate you with that one strength, and then you'll start to find referrals coming to you.
Mm-hmm. Got a question, Nick?
Yeah.
The problem I usually use to ask is like where to start.
Yep.
Like, how did you know where to exactly start? Like, besides research,
yeah.
What made you like, I have to do this position, this one specific thing first? Like, what was your determination to start? Like, what made you do that first thing?
Yeah, good question. What's your name?
Deshaun.
The honest answer is I didn't want to regret it. So again, when I was sitting there in college, I thought, oh, this would be a funny idea. What if? And again, that's kind of one of my mottos, not just for business, but life in general. Regret is literally the worst thing ever. So that's why I say, when I have all these different ideas and I'm talking about these things, if it doesn't, you know, if you're not going to expend that much to try it, just try it. You know,
right. The
worst thing that could happen is you completely fail, but you've at least learned 1 to 2
right.
things. So again, I've only highlighted 2 of my ideas. I could have also put up a slide called Nick's 7 Ideas That Sucked and Didn't Go Anywhere, but I still tried them. And again, through each of those 7, I've met 5 to 10 new people. I've met, you know, made 2 new connections. I've learned 2 new skills or something like that. So I would say regret is the driving force, which is kind of a negative outlook. But again, I don't want to say, oh man, remember when I had that idea and I, you know, just passed on it?
Right.
What if? And then 2, just opportunity. I studied econ, so I have to put an econ reference. It's opportunity cost, meaning if you don't try it, you know, You could always, there's always going to be multiple entry-level jobs and intermediate-level jobs available, so you can always be an employee of someone. That's never going to go away. So, you know, think about how cool it would be to, you know, work from your laptop or work from your phone or hire other people and have fun and actually enjoy what you're going to do. I think hands down, so in that aspect, when I thought about that, the benefit outweighed any fear or scaredness that I had.
Right. Okay, that makes sense, because how I like got into the business of wanting to do business for myself.
Yeah.
I used to do all these type things, wake up now. That was another one when I forgot the MCA and things and whatnot. I just realized it was like a pyramid scheme.
Yeah, yeah.
I just kept on getting a feeling working for myself, not waking up on somebody else's clock. And that just gave me the drive to just go and just start my own brand, my own business. And that's how I started. So I was curious. I like to ask you that question.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I guess one other piggyback on that is for your ideas. Like I mentioned, I have, you know, the 10 to 20 ideas. For every one of those, how I know how to value or rank one higher than the other, I literally go down my list and I'll sit down with someone like Tom or someone else and say, you know, or maybe you if you're in the demographic, and I'll say, would you buy this? Or what do you think about this? And if I get some good feedback beforehand, maybe I'll move that one up before my idea that, you know, people have said either wouldn't work or they're not interested in. So again, tangibly speaking, if you could launch with a customer, if you could get someone to pre-order 5 shirts, 10 shirts, which then you take that money, which is this, again, this is what I did when I was a 20-year-old kid and I didn't have money to spend.
Right.
I pre-printed 500 shirts for a big amount of money only after I knew that they were all sold. So then when I got the money, I could cover the shirts and then I made my 40%, you know, profit margins up front. So try to find your customers before you even start something. You don't have to incorporate or do those things right away.
Mm-hmm.
So you can kind of test the waters or test the market.
Maybe.
Yeah. Okay, now a switch into my current capacity. So I want to go through, again, how in Tom's introduction, I kind of talked and joked about my day job being with DuPage County. So what I do on a day-to-day basis is I work in our innovation center. I run our innovation center in Naperville. We're on a day-to-day basis. We have 25 different businesses and different entities that use the space. So I mentor 25 different companies. The idea is, if no one's heard the term incubator or co-working space, we have about 10,000 square feet, rooms like this, whiteboard rooms, private offices, open space. It's a kind of a big Starbucks, meaning people come in who have different interests, different skills, and work on building their business together. We also have a ping pong table, so it's pretty fun. So what is Rev3 again? Our focus, coming from the DuPage County background, is we wanted to build more financially viable businesses within the county. Again, how you do this, you can lower kind of the overhead cost, you can foster people, you know, communicating in a collaborative and shared environment, which is what we do. So we're a membership organization, and by virtue of being a member, you get access to all of our services. So again, I keep saying Thomas came to some of our social events. We also do office hours, so about 5 to 6 times a month, I bring mentors in and CPAs, legal, angel investors to talk about, you know, raising money. What kind of things do you have to think about before you're raising money? Why are we doing this? If any of you guys spend any time in the city, there's about 77 innovation hubs in the city. Again, I represent the 39 cities and 1 million people in DuPage County. When we started, there was a grand total of 2. So it was long overdue. People didn't know where to go. You know, people like you with those questions, you know, it helps being in a room of like-minded people and whiteboarding or going through some of these. This is that map that I referenced again. The dot on the right is obviously Chicago. You can see their tech ecosystem is going crazy. Out here, again, we only had those 2 when we started, and now on a daily basis, this will continue to be a hot topic and continue.
Nick, there's one up in Rockford now. Did you guys open it up recently?
No, that is Iger Lab, which NIU actually purchased.
Oh, I see. Okay. I've heard of that before.
They're a product development center.
Yes.
So Rev3 has 2 locations or one?
We have one. We have one in Naperville, so we're actually inside, thank you for reminding me, we're actually inside of NIU Naperville on Deal Road.
Deal Road, yeah. Nick, another question about up there in Rockford, in a little bit. What all are they doing in the way of product development up there?
So they're more contract manufacturing.
Oh, I see, okay.
Makerspace-based, meaning, sure. I don't know if anyone's into physical products, but say you wanted to mold a phone case or something, they have 3D printers that can test small scale runs, which we also have some 3D printers at our space, before you spend, you know, 20 grand and mm-hmm. do an injection mold or plastic mm-hmm. or something like that. So yeah, they're more kind of that R&D okay, industrial sure. side. Here's just a slide with some of our press and PR. I always like to point out on the top. So these are some of the tangible things that we're doing. This guy sitting here in the middle, we're partnered with an architectural firm that when we were looking for our space, an architecture firm mocked up a 3-floor building, and then they literally used an Xbox controller and Oculus Rift headset to be able to do a 360-degree view around the space. So again, these are what two previously unconnected entities can do when they come together, which is kind of one of our main points. So I made reference to, on a day-to-day basis, I oversee 25 different companies and different entities. About 60% of those are in the IT space, so digital, web, mobile, e-commerce. About 30 to 40% are kind of in that either service-based or product. Yes?
What do you mean you oversee it? What do you mean by that?
So I direct and I run the center. And then so those 25 companies are members of Rev3. And so on a day-to-day basis, you know, some of them have private offices. Some of them are co-working members, which is essentially just a space like this to kind of get out of their home office or get out of Starbucks. You can come flip open a laptop. You know, I could sit next to you building your business while I'm building mine, but it's just more that community feel.
Rev3 is basically a group of people sitting around trying to figure out what they want to do with the rest of their lives.
Some of them, but for the most part, they're either revenue generating or they're ideation. So meaning, I don't know what kind of idea that you're maybe thinking about, but we have 25 different companies who they want to use the space for a couple of reasons. Number one, they want to get out of their home office or again, you know, it's kind of hard to wake up every morning and work from your pajamas. And I talk to myself against the wall when I could be in a more shared environment. So they want access to community. They want access to, you know, show a little more formal for clients. So again, you know, rooms like this, I either rent out or my members get for free. If they want to come in and say, hey, I want to do a pitch for 5 potential investors or clients. So they want access to, you know, the better spacing. And then 3, it's the services and events, meaning, you know, they know they might be good or pretty good even by themselves, but they want to start building their network, meet people with different skills. Or terminology-wise, we're a co-working space and incubator. And so, yes, we do have some of those people who aren't sure what they want to do, but for the most part, they've either launched, or on the flip side, we've had about 4 to 5 ideas brand new that have been launched by virtue of just people coming together at the space.
Nick, can you talk a little bit more about the training programs that you have during the daytime? You had one here just, I think, on Wednesday.
Yes.
This past week, can you share a little bit about those types of things that go on there at Rev3 also?
Yes, good question. We had a sales lunch and learn.
Yep.
I think I have a slide called on our event, so
I'll highlight
our events.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
How much is membership?
Yeah, so we go from $25 a month to $1,500. $25 is social only, so again, you know, if they want to come, just get that networking aspect. Our private offices are between $800 and $1,500 a month, again, meaning they get a 24/7 access key. They want, you know, to lock their files or lock their computer in a room. That's their mailing address. So again, what we do is we're kind of lower, I don't want to say subsidizing, but we're lowering that overhead cost of starting a company. So instead of renting, you know, an office in Elmhurst or Wheaton or Naperville right away, you can start in a shared environment and then move out there. Our gym membership or our co-working membership is $200 a month. And again, that means, you know, just come and go, as much access as you want. Work from the couch, work from the room, get access to our shared conference rooms, and then get access to the mentorship hours and also the community events.
And then are you guys primarily focused on technology, or is it like any type of business?
Yep, good question. Our niche is tech and manufacturing, more specifically that prototyping. Now that being said, I have actually last year I sponsored the COD Ideas to Profits business pitch competition. So the winner of that is in my incubator. The second place was a young girl from Peru who started a fashion line. She's a member. So again, point being, we have a lot of digital, web, mobile, a lot of tech, but it's all over. I have a lawyer. I have people just, you know, wanting to go into business for themselves, maybe as an accountant. So it's kind of all over.
Do you need to want to have your business in DuPage County in order to work at
the No. No, good question though, but no, we're not DuPage County exclusive.
And then like the CPAs and lawyers that come in, do they focus on your niche or do they focus on other industries as well?
All over. And again, it's kind of a doctor's appointment. I'll bring in the attorneys or CPAs or business consultants. We do SCORE mentoring, so someone will actually look over your business plan or go through it with you. It's about 30 minutes free for any of the services each month by being a member.
At which membership price?
200 and above, yeah. Good question. Mm-hmm. Okay, so here's the slide again. Some of our members, I have graphic designers. Now again, when I say 25 members, there's 25 different entities. Some of those entities are, you know, just me by myself. Some are about 4 to 6 employees, student-led app companies, CPAs, biometrics. We have a couple tech writers, some developers, Android, mobile, a lot of cloud, a lot of e-commerce, a lot of digital marketing as well. So here's what Tom was talking about. I've hosted 100, it's actually outdated, I've hosted 175 events in the last 18 months. Again, this is everything from morning breakfast, morning coffee, lunch and learn. On Wednesday, we brought in a sales guy who has a sales podcast to talk about using LinkedIn to reach your target market. SBIR funding, real life MBA series. One of my favorite events is I brought in a Google group that hosted a Google-sponsored hackathon. So on the Android Wear watch, we came in, we formed teams of 6. We hacked some of the IoT, Internet of Things aspects, did a little pitch contest, got a prize package for the winner. So again, anyone who wants at the end can come up and grab my card. I'd be glad to send you a link to our meetup group where we post all of these, which a good amount of these, to your point, are also free of these events. Okay, this is just that quick example. I wanted to make sure and bring this up. This is the Lean Model Canvas. So again, this is one page. So instead of a 65-page business plan, it's one page. It's meant to, you know, be in a space like this where you can whiteboard it. I hold whiteboard sessions with this where we do, one of my favorite events is called Entrepreneurs Anonymous. So we started it to throw someone up in front of the room who's kind of scared to talk about their idea just starting, and we literally whiteboard with it and walk them through. So again, we could have day-long discussions on this, but just to point it out for the interested people, everything stems from the value proposition, obviously. That's why that's in the middle. So again, I'd encourage anyone either with an idea or launching a new one, that's what you have to have first. What are you doing? Who are you serving? Why are they going to choose you or your product or service over anyone else? In red, this is something I kind of added in, and this goes back to the question earlier. I think everyone kind of has an internal value prop too, meaning I might be telling the world, you know, my iPhone is better than an Android, but what's the real reason I started my business? Again, is it because you're scared? Is it because you want to work for yourself? Is it because you want to make money? Is it because you want to influence people? Whatever it may be, again, goes back to my theme of being self-aware and being honest enough with yourself to know what those reasons are. Of course, then we get into costs, revenue streams, costs of goods, key resources, key activities. And again, when the way that this is actually made is you're supposed to sticky note and post-it note it. So again, if things change, maybe one of your revenue streams has changed or fallen off, you just replace it, you pivot, and you keep going. Again, if anyone wants more information on that, I could send out a link, or you can Google on Lean Model Canvas. Again, on the bottom right, so this is kind of what I was mentioning too. I have one company who is a manufacturing company, so they do some of this prototyping. They have a couple engineers. Again, so we kind of mesh that software with that hardware aspect. So this is cool, actually, and this is happening tomorrow. I'm sponsoring TEDx Naperville. This is from the TED Talks 2 years ago in Naperville. One of my members 3D printed and CNC'd life-size items of Alien versus Predator, AVP the movie, and his business was he sold to graphic designers and to movie studios who, you know, needed props. Again, this guy had a 9-to-5 job. He just bought a 3D printer, kind of started this on the side. Lo and behold, a year and a half later, he has 3 3D printers, and he quit his day job, and that's his niche, that's his industry.
Linda, can you tell us a little bit about TED Talk, please?
Yeah, so I wish there were still tickets. It's actually sold out tomorrow. There's gonna be, you know, 500 people there, 500, you know, genius thinkers, bright minds in different spaces. But that event, I'm sure some of you have probably seen TED Talks on YouTube. TEDx means it's a licensed charter of the broad TED organization. So I know the guy who runs this one, he puts it on, he brings great speakers in. There's about 10 to 15 minutes of, you know, innovative big picture thinking. And then there's just networking. Again, back to my bigger theme, you know, you could always Google or through Meetup. You know, I posted this event in our Meetup. But again, this is how you get in and connect with the community. The one that I mentioned in 2013 that I sponsored, again, I had just graduated. It was my first job. I went to this and I came away with a stack of business cards of CEOs, of consultants, of tech people, who again, now to this day, whenever I get, you know, questions that come to me, I'm throwing them referrals, they're throwing me referrals. So again, I'm starting to build that relationship and build their skill sets and build my own as well. But it is a great event. They're really fun. That is where to find Rev3. Again, if you grab my card, all this is available, and I'd be happy to invite you guys out to any of our events. And with that, that's all. So if there's any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Martin, I know you have some questions. We've talked